Welcome to the first 2017 lecture from the Center for 21st Century Studies. We are pleased and privileged to have Cindi Katz from the City University of New York here with us. Cindi Katz has been writing in geography, in feminist geography, in critical, critical geography for many years. A lot of us have read her work over the years. The first time I read an essay of hers co-written with Neil Smith, it was on space as a metaphor. And as you can probably guess from the time that we talked about metaphors as being a creative and interesting way of doing social critique, that was a while ago. She has, in many ways, brought geography into the 21st century. She has helped redefine what its contours are, what its subjects are, what we look at, where we look, how deeply we look into, say, interpersonal relations, and in her most recent work, especially into the lives of children. What are the spaces that children entail? What is seen and unseen in the worlds of childhood, along terms of policy, along terms of aesthetics, along terms of meaning? She continually expands what we think of geography as being able to do. And so I'm very pleased to welcome her here. Before she speaks, I would like to point out a couple of things. One is she'll be talking until about 4:45 or 5 o'clock. At the end of that, you are all invited to head upstairs to the 9th floor, where we will join her in a reception. So please make a plan to do that afterward. So join me in welcoming Cindi Katz.
Thank you all for being here, and thanks for that lovely introduction. And it's very exciting and a privilege to be speaking at this center in its 49th year. It's wonderful. I took a little bit seriously, and after the last few days, I think we'll take more seriously the whole idea of refusal and naysaying. That's the theme for this year for the center. So the title of my talk is Refusing Mastery, the Detroit Geographical Expedition and Institute as Minor Theory. Now, I was initially drawn to thinking about the minor from an article by the film theorist Tom Gunning, I think taught here a long time ago, correct? No?
He's been here a number of times.
But he never taught here. He claimed it. No, I just false claims. Alternative facts. They're never going to live that one down. Who wrote an article on minor cinema in the Journal of Motion Picture. And it provided a sort of backdoor for me to Deleuze and Guattari's Kafka towards minor literature. I got to Deleuze and Guattari through the visual, and I left through the theoretical. But in each register, I felt a kinship with the ways the minor worked, and the way it reworks and decomposes the major from within. I loved its aspiration to revolutionary consciousness through a disavowal of mastery and the embrace of marginality. But it was a marginality that recognizes and relates to all of its edges and all that it edges. A marginality that's more interstitial than marginal. And to quote the father and family guy in his film review of The Godfather, it insists upon itself, Lois. as part of the flux of any theoretical formation and practical terrain that it creates and inhabits. And it probably should not even be called marginal, because I think it puts it it makes people think in a marginal way. And just this week, I went to see Kerry James Marshall's show at the Met Breuer called Mastery without the E. And I think that's, to me, it was a perfectly minor sort of painting where he really engages all of art history in a way and reworks it and insists on its importance and its many kind of formalistic connections, but also reworks that history. And the exhibit is done on Sunday, but very interestingly had a room of works from the Metropolitan Museum of Art's collection that he chose as having been his influences. And it ranged from, Renaissance painters and to Gerhard Richter's very quite abstract things, and Dürer. And he said why each influenced him. And it was really it was really interesting to see in his head, but it really played into that idea of the reworking of the masters to insist on a different way of representing blackness and composition and place and meaning. And it really does illuminate what I think of as the minor in the deepest sense. So, and that, in that deepest sense, is political. And that's everywhere in the minor, and especially in what feels most personal. And that has deep resonances with Deleuze and Guattari's understanding of the inseparability of the personal and political, which of course connected with me as a feminist, with feminist theory and practice, and struck a chord when I encountered it at first. It was the way I did theory, and these works gave it a name and a practice, and gave it a new horizon for my thinking and doing. So even the sense of the situation was in keeping with how Deleuze and Guattari explained literature. As Gunning quotes, minor literature begins by expressing itself and doesn't conceptualize until afterward. For me, conceptualizing was the ammunition for a critique of some academic big boys and the start of what I thought would be an exchange on the politics of knowledge. My strategy was to write about minor theory in a non-minor way, to show I could talk the talk, but my gambit didn't provoke a response, at least not in print. I received various gratifying responses from others who considered themselves to be minor theorists of a sort, but mostly jokey ones from colleagues and friends who didn't. One colleague did tell me that the paper I wrote 20 years ago towards minor theory made more of an impact than I'd ever know. And had he not conveyed that intriguing message, I would have assumed that the piece was even more of a dead letter than it appeared to be. And I know it bothered some big boys, and I will insist on calling them that to my dying day, but nobody engaged it in print, and it dignified it with a response that was published, but rather would say, over dinner, well, I'm a major theorist, I can't understand that, or something. But maybe I was just addressing the whole piece wrongly. Because 20 years later, it seems like it's reached a more receptive audience and a more enlivening destination. I don't know why I can't see today, but I'm going to have to. Could someone hold this up? there, that's better. And it thrills me. But still, as I wrote at the time, we all have investments in how theory is done and how it is valorized. And I wanted to provoke masculinist Marxists and post-structuralist theorists into a deeper engagement with feminist thought and minor ways of theorizing. I was saying no to something, but as an invitation, or perhaps an opening salvo to something else. I should note, not only was feminist thought not the only form of minor theorizing, it was not necessarily minor. That would destabilize these bodies of theory, when the whole point of minor theory and theorizing is that it's relational and fluid. But still, I did want to scratch at what I thought of as major theory and with something else, and thus my provocation. So now, even though I'm confident that I like and it's useful to work in this register, and I know I have good company in it, I cared and still care about who cares. Every refusal is, after all, an engagement, a potential opening or site to gather and reframe, rework, and resist. My stake in jarring those theories and to decompose them remains. Minor theory is a project and a practice that should matter to those whose work it engages, not just because of recognition, though that matters, but because of all the kinds of questions, categories, and analyses it opens up are useful for understanding and engaging uneven social relations of production and reproduction in a range of registers. But also, as the Kerry James Marshall work made clear to me this week, is to see all work differently. So by seeing it, you see the other stuff differently. The draw in thinking about and doing minor theory, then, is its intent to use major forms in an altered and decomposing way, to undo these forms and practices from within. A politics of refusal, but also producing ruptures and what Deleuze and Guattari called lines of escape, so that something else is possible, something else happens or is glimpsed from the interstices, nudged fleetingly into place, or shoved lastingly. To do minor theory is to make conscious use of displacement, of not being at home, of refusing to be at home, or of being between homes, so that new subjectivities, spatialities, and temporalities might be marked and produced in spaces of betweenness that reveal the limits of the major as it is transformed along with the minor. Working in a minor theoretical mode is to recognize that those subjectivities, spatialities, temporalities are embodied and situated and fluid, and their productions of knowledge are inseparable from, and or if not completely absorbed in, the mess of everyday life. It's not a distinct body of theory, but rather a way of working differently, inside out, fugitive moves and emergent practices, interstitial with the major, as I've said. There's no outside here. Minor theory and practice are not about a politics of the margins, but rather call forth interstitial negotiations, reworking spaces, and to make something new. Can't see. Minor theory questions major theory and celebrates its distinctions from it, but it also moves to alter the constitution and construction of major theory and the subjectivities associated with it both. I think that that shift, the possibilities of unmooring known knowns, to quote another family guy, Rumsfeld, categories we know to look for and thus find, was deeply threatening to major theorists and remains so. My recognizing the forms, practices, and politics of minor theory was a way of situating myself and so many others as players in the field and not players in a minor league. It remains, though, that minor theory did not get much public attention from geographers in the two decades after I wrote about it. The idea was raised in just a few scattered articles. But in the last couple of years, interest in minor theory and the minor as such has picked up in gratifying and compelling ways. Among other things, it was the theme of a critical geography conference last year. There was a course at Yale, a Yale studio in minor architecture. There were a couple of panels at the Association of American Geographers meeting. There's going to be a forum published on it in the journal Society and Space. And so I can't call this a resurgence of interest, so I call it a surgence of interest. And I wonder what has produced this surgence of interest right now. What political, social, cultural relations and conditions, both in my field, which is geography, but in the worlds we inhabit in our everyday lives and in our institutional everyday lives, might be calling forth this interest and this sort of analysis. We are all too aware, painfully aware, of the many reasons to say no in the present political climate. But what possibilities does minor theory offer for thinking and acting differently in the face of growing economic inequality at all scales, persistent and increasingly exposed violence against people of color, intensifying environmental crises, joblessness, and social relations of production and reproduction that remain exploitative and oppressive in their articulations with race, gender, and sexuality? Is it useful to think about and try and construct alternative subjectivities, spatialities, and temporalities under these conditions? If the minor is charged with political immediacy and possibility, as the Critical Geography Conference call put it, and is a, quote, singularly connected to an event at hand, improvisational, as Erin Manning framed it in her recent book, The Minor Gesture, what does that mean for practice or for the production of knowledge? And so if I initially entered minor theory through the visual and left through the theoretical, I now want to engage the political and the practical to conjure a kind of praxis out of it. And I'll mostly do this in relation to social reproduction as and in crisis. But to do so, I want to discuss the Detroit Geographical Expedition and Institute, which I'm mostly going to call the DGEI. I don't have enough time to say that phrase as many times as I'll need to. But the DGEI was a project of radical geography in the 1960s and 70s, which I read as minor theory in practice, deeply concerned with social reproduction and of great relevance to current crises and political movements such as Black Lives Matter and Occupy and what has been stirring in the wake of Trump's election and inauguration. So the crisis of social reproduction and minor theory as praxis. The current crises of racial capitalism, of the Anthropocene, of state and domestic violence are crises of social reproduction, experienced through and in the body, on the street, in the home, in schools, in prison cells, and detention centers. The insecurities spurred by these crises and their effects are visceral and sprawling, and I fear about to get a lot worse. They are, of course, structural, but they are encountered and made sensible through everyday life. The intimate effects of dispossession are global, and it may be that galvanizing an effective response to them must travel similar circuits. Major theory may tell us how racial capitalism and patriarchy work, or how these relations of production and reproduction take their tolls in violence, dispossession, accumulation, and all matter of interconnected uneven developments. But more than not, it's a broad brushstroke analysis that doesn't illuminate much about how these social relations work, let alone how they feel. And so we talk in geography lately about planetary urbanism. But really, how is that experience in different urban places? Indexing the way these problems are encountered and lived, refused and reimagined in different forms and places and scales might enable the construction of assemblages that work the relays among these forms of exploitation, oppression, violence, and offer new responses to them. Minor theory can work these connections, opening up spaces that do not deny the power of capitalism, social relations, or the theories that explain them, but which may reveal the limits in ways that suggest new means to undo them. It's never been enough, and certainly is not enough any longer, to analyze the production and reproduction of value, the dialectic of accumulation by dispossession, or the flows of capital and labor. Of course, these analyses are important at every turn. But it's also necessary to understand the concrete nature of these abstract social relations as they are lived and reworked. How can knowing how these changes in social relations are experienced spur ways to make these grounds, the grounds on which they take place, more congenial, habitable, cooperative? Minor theory attends to the differentiated concrete realms in which gendered racial capitalism is encountered, known, and felt, and gets at the fear and insecurity that keep these relations in place and keep the structures of capitalism moored in place. The myriad cultural forms and practices that secure hegemony and the relays that connect these structures and might undo them. Just as minor theory undoes the major from within, so might attending to the material social practices through which hegemony is secured in everyday life help mobilize a more lithe and powerful response. Maybe we put too much credence in what persists, to paraphrase Manning again, in the endurance of the same in theory and practice, which obscures what else is possible and even what already is. And I know that good and bad can happen from that, because certainly the change, the thing that we're hearing now, is, well, this is, we're doing everything differently. But the power of saying no to what persists, and or this is all the way it's always been, opens doors that are not necessarily seen when the focus is on what stays. So thinking about the surgence of interest in minor theory these days, it might be useful to think about these sorts of moments as conjunctures for thinking and for new thinking and grounds for action, or in keeping with the theme here of how various events, actions, contestations enter into or are brought into the present themselves to construct and rework any particular present and period. Likewise, what events and struggles are forgotten, left out, left on the wayside of different time spaces, and once as effects of and help to construct interpretive assumptions that hold sway for a time in a particular place. So along with minor theory, and actually preceding it a bit, has been a renewed interest in the significant, one of the most significant projects in geography, and certainly in radical geography, the Detroit Geographical Expedition and Institute, which is something I've participated in and in which I feel I have a stake. So I want to think about the DGEI as an example of minor theory and practice, peeling away the onion of its practical engagements, its theorizations, its participants, problems, and historiographies, so that its minor attributes are revealed in examples for contemporary theory and practice, and move from its praxis as reflected in new narratives to some current projects in which my students, colleagues, and I are involved. As I revisit 1960s Detroit and its multiple radical projects, most notably for me here, the DGEI, but also DRUM, the Dodge Revolutionary Union of Machinists, and other Detroit-based activist organizations, such as those associated with James and Grace Lee Boggs, who most recently for the last 25 years have had Detroit Summer, which is a youth organizing and cultural activist project ongoing since she died last year. But that began in 1992. And I want to think through some of the conditions and interpretive assumptions that enable that time and place to resonate as a time space for contemporary inquiry, to think alongside its accomplishments, its failures, its fables, about which there are many, and to see what might have to say about new field imaginaries and possibilities for radical practice in and outside geography. So the DGEI was an extraordinary collective endeavor that arose in the aftermath of the 1967 uprisings and brought together academics and neighborhood residents to engage in collaborative geographical research. It was also the institute part was to produce a pipeline, to use present nomenclature, to higher education that was radical in every way. The DGEI set up shop in Fitzgerald, a neighborhood in northwest central Detroit, and rerouted the school to street to factory pipeline to one that was school to street to university, which really shook things up on the street and in the university. As the DGEI took shape in Fitzgerald, it claimed for itself that it was not a nice geography. No, this is any nice geography, but it was certainly not one, and not a status quo geography, but a community-defined practice of geography in action and as action. And it drew on the skills and history and tools of geography with a twist, two twists, a disciplinary twist away from the descriptive regionalism and quantitative antidote to the descriptive regionalism, which both characterized mid-century American geography, and also a twist that was a political one that took the tools of empire, the expedition, the map, the survey, and tried to turn them on their heads so that the power of the, quote, expedition was in the hands of people being explored, and what was explored came out of the experience and spurred the consciousness of powers, effect, and place. Well, I'm going to take some time to describe the work and aspirations of the DGEI, attending to its methodologies as praxis, its effects, and its lessons as exemplifying in many ways what I understand as minor theory and practice. I'm also interested in the ways the project and its afterlives have been excavated and examined to rework and reimagine geography as a discipline and a field of practice in recent years. This renaissance is itself a minor intervention in geography and in its dominant field imaginaries. The DGEI was a revolutionary project of geographical knowledge production and exchange whose perils and potentials were fading from memory by the 1980s. So just 15 years or so, it was a kind of forgotten alternative of how geography might be done and learned. Really, its forgetting was willed. Its history was erased, not just by a conservative profession and university apparatus that exiled its lead practitioner, William Bungie, but even by the left, who saw it as wildly utopian, all the more impossible as they or we got professionalized and absorbed in our own professionalization and the accommodations it required. And our theoretical preoccupations often took a turn for the major. The DGEI was left in the dust of sort of being empirical or applied geography during the post-structuralist turn in geography, with its interest in more in theorizing difference than in the commons, which now captivates so much intellectual and political imagination. So remembering the DGEI reactivates the past and opens a path to revitalize geographies of practice and possibility, not just in the discipline, but more broadly. And it also speaks to the potency of the construction and reconstruction of any field's periodization of the period of metaphors. You know, we can mark ourselves as we turn into aging, whatever we are, by what was the trend or what was the language or what was the discourse at this time or another, not to say that then it goes away, but it evolves and it has its critiques as such. But what can we retrieve and revivify in contemporary practice from those past practices and the refusals for the current moment, and what geographies do they make possible in all kinds of places? Places that might include Ferguson, Baltimore, Milwaukee, Charleston, New York City, or Oakland, as well as Detroit, as still and again. The activist intellectual work of this band of 1960s geographers with revolutionary aspirations, as I said, used the tools of geography in a minor key. But what did they use them for? They mapped rats and words and flows of capital and children's pain. Their productions and exchanges of knowledge were organizing as geographical imaginations in action, insisting on memory as infrastructure, kind of the heart and mind of the city being no less important to its physical bones of buildings and bridges and roads. And a memory as infrastructure and history as possibility. The DGEI was a collective practical engagement with the city that aspired to document, analyze, interrupt, and reroute the multiple trajectories of what was then called slum formation that were ongoing in 1960s as white flight and the decentralization of the automobile industry, which began in the 1950s, accelerated. It's important to remember that the decentralization of the automotive industry was impelled in part by union activism and the successes of various strikes, Wildcat and otherwise, and enabled by the automobile itself and the enormous infrastructure that supported it. The state-sponsored development of the interstate highways in the 1950s advanced sprawl and destroyed directly and indirectly much of the urban fabric of the U.S. in general and Detroit in particular. Highway construction divided residential neighborhoods, as I'm sure you're all aware, and was a major tool of urban renewal targeted at poor and non-white neighborhoods, including Fitzgerald. The shifting tax base to the suburbs further decimated the infrastructure and public services of Detroit. Labor and community response, unrest in response, led to massive uprisings in 1967 that were met with police and other forms of state violence, and ultimately the so-called planned shrinkage of the city, the effects of which remain palpable 50 years later. The DGEI was part of this mix. Launched in 1968, it was a community-based collective of what they called folk geographers. It was the 1960s. Academic geographers, young people, whether students, high school students, graduate students, undergraduate students, and school leavers and residents. At its best, it was a community of practice sharing knowledge, skills, memories, and imagined futures. Its ambitious and exhilarating project was to work the grounds of 1 square mile of the city after 1967, to understand the very fibers of its existence so that political, economic, historical, geographical processes engulfing it might be deflected, rejected, undone, a kind of saying no as politics. As they wrote in the recently republished keystone text, Fitzgerald, Geography of a Revolution, republished by University of Georgia Press, they saw Fitzgerald as America, as containing the story of the nation itself. Just as a drop of blood can tell the health of a patient, so could the conditions that could be found and the histories in one square mile plot. The overall intent was to produce an analysis of the spaces of nature, this is their word, nature, humankind, and machines at five scales: the neighborhood, the metropolis, the nation, the continent, the planet. Why not? They were nothing if not bold, but they also, and this is key, started where they were. They focused on the quotidian and attended to the contradictions they saw around them. And I see this as working in a minor key. And see this as in the best of their efforts as of a piece with Stefano Harney and Fred Moten's idea of the undercommons, collective study and experimentation, what they Stefano Harney and Fred Moten call procedural architecture for political openings that might lead anywhere. DGEI was co-directed by Wayne State geographer William Bungie, who with his family had taken up residence in Fitzgerald in the early 1960s, and a militant high school leaver from the neighborhood, Gwendolyn Warren. They were a formidable, unlikely, and somewhat unholy alliance. At the time, Bill Bungie was a giant white guy, and from actually a ruling class or a very wealthy family, and very angry and somewhat crazy. And Gwendolyn Warren was 16 years old and a little skinny black girl. And the two of them were like a power, a real force to contend with, and really did amazing work, and I think also probably drove each other crazy. But that's a different story. But guided by community participants, most of whom were young, expedition members mapped land use of the most elemental kind. They mapped their rage at the crumbling they saw around them, and trained and energized a phalanx of militant and well-informed geographers to do the same. So among things that I think are like brilliantly mundane phenomena that they documented and mapped were what a child touches, so the tactile environment of the neighborhood. They asked basic and deeply political geographical questions about slum formation, reckoned in such things as machine space versus play space. If you ever try and walk around Milwaukee and see where the garbage trucks are, or where railroad sidings are, or where storage, the machine space is not in the wealthier neighborhoods, as you can probably imagine without those maps. But if you compare it to open space, neighborhood play space, it really makes clear how geography works and how space is inhabited and makes certain kinds of subjectivities. They mapped traffic accidents involving children. They mapped childless spaces, hard boundaries, like walls and fortress exteriors. They mapped rats, rat bites, broken glass, dead trees, residential sales, and the racial and class composition of the residential and commercial areas. And they mapped words that they saw. So like all storefronts, you know, if it says check cans cashing or beer, or what kinds of words you see in the neighborhood and how those words produce the space. And they had this in an atlas called the Atlas of Love and Hate. Not a bestseller, but an amazing document, as you can imagine. Their work was intensive and revealing. In one schoolyard, for instance, they used like archaeological methods, and they made a one square yard. They should have done a meter, but we don't convert in this country. One square yard of the schoolyard, and they counted how many sharp objects were in that one square yard and how many pieces of broken glass, and there were 59 pieces of broken glass and jagged objects, which weighed 6.5 ounces. And then they multiplied these findings by the size of the schoolyard to make this startling revelation, I have this idea about that it contained 820,690 jagged objects weighing 2.8 tons. And this wasn't the worst schoolyard in the neighborhood. But that's how disinvestment is felt and how its workings are known. Of course, it's troubling, or maybe not, to think that urban pioneers might be gardening in these spaces now, which they think of as conventional. Landscape histories matter, and understanding those is critical. As the DGEI's field notes, they published four sets of field notes, mimeographed documents, which three of which are available online, or some they're somehow available from the library. But one of the field notes says, if you went down, this was the epigraph, 12th Street or down Mac, to any such place, and you saw that street, what would you be able to read on that landscape? What would we be able to read on that landscape that you couldn't? And there was plenty, of course. The DGEI revolved around knowledge action. Their meticulous field research was already part of a strategy for making community-based stand against these depredations, for making them broadly sensible in a new register and to other populations, and for altering people's capacities and sense of themselves in the world. Depending where you stood, Fitzgerald was seen as somewhere between a slum and a thriving community. And the expedition asked questions like whether and how the neighborhood might be regenerated forever. They didn't see this as a utopian question. At the heart of their project was an educational imperative. It was an expedition and institute. And that latter came more from the community, whereas the research expeditionary part came more from the academics. But even that was rerouted by the community participants. The idea was that the community would be doing its own research and theorizing about the issues it faced. Fitzgerald was its first site, but the knowledge, insights, and political energy it generated in the community and its academic partners were themselves generative. Later expeditions focused on the Trumbull neighborhood in Detroit, the east side of Vancouver, and Toronto. But perhaps most important in the end was the extension program in neighborhood education they developed. The Institute was dialectically connected to the expedition and was established initially through the University of Michigan and then Michigan State, both of which were soon destroyed because of the program's deeply radical nature. Among its features were, and I say this to myself and to other faculty in the room, were that the faculty worked through tithing their time. So the pay they got, they plowed into paying for the tuition and for the expenses of the program. And that that's something that I don't know a lot of people would do today. But it was like a lot of people from all over the country came and taught there for free. The faculty worked through tithing. There was open enrollment for students who did most of the community, as much community as classroom work. The tuition, I said, was paid for by the salaries of the faculty or was free. And the program was administered by the community participants. And they were insisted on being based at the campuses of the state's best universities, with an insistence that those resources be available to these community-based action researchers. Their model was the extension education programs for rural youth, and were part of the land-grant university system, which included Michigan State. Somehow, though, when the extension education was provided for non-white, radicalized urban youth, it wasn't seen in the same way by the state. I know that would be shocking. Even as capital, aided by the state, was derailing the employment possibilities of black people in Detroit, it was not interested in giving serious attention to universities as possible futures for disenfranchised young people. But to say something I said earlier today, not because there was no money. The school-to-prison pipeline is more costly than the school-to-university pipeline, as anyone in a disinvested university like here or my own could tell you. They're getting a lot for a little, and not the same in the carceral environment. The trajectory of in Detroit is of a piece with CUNY, where I teach, in stating tuition in the 1970s as black students enrolled in larger and larger numbers. And of course, here in Wisconsin, the beat goes on, and refusing these kind of attacks and assault is critical. The educational program of the DGEI drew on a case study method of instruction. The first case focused on school desegregation and decentralization and was drawn on by then State Senator Coleman Young and future Detroit mayor to analyze redistricting possibilities. Their plan, which was derailed by those in power, would have redressed some of the most pressing issues of equity, social justice, and integration facing the local black community, and it did not appear coincidental to anyone that its development coincided with Michigan State's dismantling of the program associated with the Institute in favor of accepting individual students as regular students of the university. Right around the same time, Bungie was denied tenure at Wayne State, so there was a kind of concerted collapse of the project. Though the program, the educational program, was not without its problems, but it was destroyed by, among other things, an academic administration that refused to forge, let alone nurture, any meaningful link between intellectual resources of a state university system and the needs and interests of poor people in Detroit. I'm tracing these contours of this project to show that another world was in the making, and its promises and possibilities were actively undermined by those in power: university administrators, state and municipal representatives, real estate investors, among others. Remembering the work and failures of the Detroit Geographical Expedition and Institute and telling its stories is intended to produce a political imaginary for the present, a field of possibilities as much as possibilities for a field. Exemplary suggestions, to use Peter Linebaugh's phrase, for thinking and acting, which both frames a period and glimpses another. My recounting it here is to open up the possibility of some future pasts and past futures for radical political action, imagination, and to show minor theory in practice. The DGEI offered a radical break with dominant positivist traditions and interrupted the complacency of geographical inquiry to examine relational questions on the ground with no pretense of so-called objectivity in the positivist sense, what Sandra Hand Parting would later call weak objectivity. It was theoretical in the deepest sense, that is, in relation to the historical geographies of lived experience. They looked at the uneven geographical distribution of resources, the histories of land occupation and exploitation, the everyday effects of racial capitalism. They valued participatory research and collaborative writing all the way down, though at times their division of labor was problematic, as was their mode of theory building, which retained vestiges of positivism and could veer towards major, particularly among the academics who led by Bungie. All of this notwithstanding, the DGEI and its academic participants were instrumental in spurring the shift to radical geography in the 1960s, associated with the founding of the Union of Socialist Geographers, which no longer exists, and the journal Antipode, which is thriving. These movements, if you will, blossomed into a thousand forms of radical and then critical geography over the years. Those enduring becomings, of course, continue. Though in thinking about minor theory, I'm trying to nudge us away from focusing on what persisted so as to see what was perhaps fleeting, what was indeterminate, what was emergent, or what even failed along the way, and might be currently in our midst to shake things up now and here. Yet as the field tilted more towards critical than radical after the 60s and 70s, many of the practitioners associated with the DGEI and its offsprings in Vancouver and Toronto dispersed to far-flung academic positions and other professions, or exiled from the academy, the project faded from our collective memory. For various reasons, political, academic, and embodied, in the 1990s, some of us started to retrace and reflect on the history of radical geography. As the DGEI was recalled and rehabilitated, people often sought out Bill Bungie, the larger-than-life founder of the DGEI, who was self-exiled in Canada and working as a taxi driver in Toronto. After not getting tenure at Wayne State and unquietly, and I mean unquietly, taking up and being taken up in various temporary academic positions. He was brilliant and ballistic, and despite his extraordinary contributions to two of geography's intellectual revolutions, the quantitative and the radical, he was pretty much banished from the field. Avoided even by friends and comrades as the years passed. And to that point, he recently died, and no one in the profession of geography, even those who championed the DGEI, knew about it. It's a really kind of tragic sort of story. Though I was a deep admirer of the DGEI's accomplishments and praxis, I wrote about it in a critical way about its sexist, racist, imperial undertow in a piece for a 1996 book on feminist methodology. That undertow was a big part of the project's undoing. It was called an expedition, and geography as a profession needs always to be mindful of its imperial and military entailments. Radical geography all the more so. Even though the DGEI was intended to turn these entailments on their head by having the explorers be natives who were exploring their home terrain in order to restore it and reclaim it, what we might now call counter-mapping, still the expeditionary language got in their way. Although part of why I consider the DGEI a project of minor theory and practice was that many of its practitioners, as its praxis, worked to undo that language and its entailments. But Bungie had a weakness for essentializing race and gender, which undermined his relationships with many community members and led him to write things, and I quote, "Theorizing is manly work." Go home, girls. Still, he was a radical visionary, and as the DGEI was brought back into the field's consciousness, people sought out Big Bill, always paying their respects to Ms. Warren as co-director, but not seeking her out, or perhaps even thinking that she had a story to tell. I had harbored a plan to find her, but I didn't do anything about it for a long time. But in 2012, I launched an expedition of my own. But since I'm incapable of manly work, I Googled her. And by Googling Gwendolyn Warren, I found her in a matter of hours. So the key to finding her was, for one, realizing that she probably was not still in Detroit. You know, because at first I was looking in Detroit, and half the city is gone. Why would she not be one of them? But also to think that, to realize that she and I were just a few years apart. So we're from the same generation. We were part of radical politics in different places in different times. And it was really jarring to me to think, oh yeah, I write about the fallacy of the ethnographic present, but I imagine her like still in Detroit and imagine her still this little skinny girl when she's, you know, just a couple years older than I am. So it was not hard to find her. It's not an unusual name, so I had to like kind of figure out her age and had to figure out, oh, this one who's causing trouble in Miami in the newspaper about the school system, I bet that's her. And it was. So it's too much to go into here, but she had no idea that the DGEI had any lasting effect on the field, or that people were recovering its history in conversation with Bungie, and that some of its academic participants in the project, or through the reissue of Fitzgerald. But she quickly noted that community participants were nowhere in the contemporary narrative. The major lineage narrative was encroaching on the minor, which had been so much what the DGEI had been. In a conversation that I had with her, which is available online or available for streaming in October 2014, she at CUNY, she said she was a high school dropout and already an organizer against the terrible public schools in Detroit when the DGEI came to her neighborhood and discovered her and her organization / gang called the Infernos. And she referred to their earliest roles in the project as their Sacagawea. And that kind of damning language was not part of the written lore or its recent recovery by radical geographers, and it was certainly sobering and discomforting to anyone who does community-based research. Her description of the ways neighborhood participants, particularly young people, had pushed back and helped reshape and in many ways define the project are instructive. What Warren said speaks volumes not only about the DGEI and about youth organizing, but perhaps similar in its energy and creativity to and its misrecognition to what has happened in the streets of Baltimore, Ferguson, and so many other places. Found and transformed by her engagements with the project and close working relationships with Bungie and his colleagues, Gwendolyn was clear that one of the most profound and lasting, if dispersed, effects of the project was its educational component. The altered subjectivities and new becomings associated with minor theory were experienced widely, and not just by community participants, but by the academics as well. She, for example, completed a bachelor's and master's degrees at Michigan State, and she acknowledges that neither of those would have happened without the DGEI. And then she worked in a variety of nonprofits, government offices, and public advocacy, as she put it, until she would get too far and get let go and then find a new place to start again. So the feisty girl who co-directed the DGEI and called many of its shots was alive and well. And she was on the brink of retirement when we met. She was clearly about to retire but not ready to rest. And the return of the DGEI in her life, which initially shocked her and made her suspicious, unfolded as an opportunity for her to continue her fight for justice through other means in an expanded field. So becoming really is ceaseless when relational situations for study and experimentation, to use Morton and Harney's word, are created for and by praxis. Obviously, time to stop. Even her first steps in that effort totally altered the field imaginary, and I invited her to two panels when the AAG meetings were in Tampa, and she listened. She was on this panel, and she listened to Trevor Barnes, who's an esteemed radical geographer and was instrumental in the republication of Fitzgerald, the book, described the history of the DGEI, and then she stood up and she just said, "That's not how I remembered it." It was just amazing, and the audience was mesmerized. It was a big ballroom, and people were crying. You know, she just captured so much in her telling of what it had been. And she said, "Academics, you need to check yourself. Community, you need to know what you want and how to say it to get results." In the course of our developing relationship, Gwendolyn asked for and read everything that had been written about the DGEI. She reread her own writings from the time, including two of the four published field notes and a handful of reports and presentations, and was surprised and somewhat infuriated that a number of her academic partners, graduate students or young faculty at the time, had, as she put it, made their careers off us. She was sort of amazed but gratified that radical geographer Rich Heyman had used one of her consciousness-searing phrases as the title of a 2007 Antipode article on the DGEI and the democratization of knowledge production, and the sentence was, "Who's going to man the factories and be the sexual slaves if we all get PhDs?" Indeed, that was the radical promise of the DGEI at its limit. As Moten and Harney might put it, they were creating problems that are truly productive of inquiry, not ready answers, but improvisation that opened up possibilities and for theory and practice. I'm going to just skip the kind of ether of the practice of Detroit at that time. I think I've said enough about that, but want to say in conclusion that the success of the Institute part of the DGEI relative to the expeditionary part was palpable. And it may seem small potatoes when we look at the devastation of Detroit and think, you know, all of that work did not stem the tide of what was happening in Detroit with deindustrialization and deconcentration and the effects of racialized capitalism. But to think about the fact that hundreds of students, hundreds of kids from the neighborhood, and it seemed to be 400 or so, went to the university. Now, this is not salvation, as we all know, but really transformed their lives, their life chances, so that when we live in a time when the idea of a jobless future has become a commonplace for so many, even children of privilege, and the school-to-prison pipeline is an accepted phrase for something hideously routine, Gwendolyn's question of who's going to man the factories is all the more searing today. And in the face of the United States' profoundly racialized carceral state, the enduring and every day more visible police violence against black people, the intensification of economic inequality and political mobilization condensed around the phrase Black Lives Matter, and not as chattel, not as waste. There is not no money, and we know it costs more. The carceral state costs more than public education. So it's time to refuse again, still, whatever, and muster the will and organizing and power to reroute the pipelines the racial capitalist state has dug so deep, including the Dakota Access Pipeline, I suppose, while I'm at it, The DGEI is inspirational here. It not only altered participant subjectivity, but the intention to the everyday experience of community lived on the ground, of racialized disinvestment and dispossession. The DGEI produced that flash of recognition that things could be otherwise, the mimetic possibilities of the minor in action. Gwendolyn Warren's, and this is conclusion, intervention in the historiography of radical geography and the DGEI in particular has several implications hinted at here. Not least, how easy it was to get young people engaged in investigating and changing the conditions of their lives. So I want to conclude by thinking about the implication of these contradictory questions for the present. Why the 1960s has particular resonance for contemporary thought and action, and what sorts of cautionary tales listening to a neglected voice in a forgotten alternative might tell us at this moment, so our practice can be built in a different way from the last. Here I want to think about the DGEI in the same vein as Kristen Ross has about the Paris Commune in her wonderful work, Communal Luxury. Even if by comparison the DGEI is only a capillary, the DGEI was for the 4 years of its existence a lived alternative, and in its instantiation offered possibilities for imagining life and everyday practice otherwise and acting on it. In its time, it was known and meaningful in many black communities all around the U.S., struggling in the wake of uprisings of the 1960s and the hollowing out of urban neighborhoods from a combination of disinvestment, redlining, landlord abandonment, so-called urban renewal, deconcentration of key industries. Its actions and aspirations made a field of possibilities for radicalism, for making Black Lives Matter, for confronting police violence, and for addressing enduring racial disparities in wealth and opportunity, and making the grounds of everyday life a place where plants, animals, children can grow and thrive. I don't have to say that we are in an urgent political moment not so different from the 1960s, and I guess worse. It calls for a serious analysis and forms of urgent data produced with the sort of collective engagement of the DGEI at its best. These issues and the means to confront them are at once global and intimate, embodied and analytical. So I conclude in those registers. In a workshop that when Gwendolyn visited CUNY that we held in fall 2014, she met with several groups of activists that my colleagues and students and I work with, all of whom are different organizations who are involved in over-policing, stop and frisk, privatization of public housing, termination of the work experience program, which was community land trusts and homelessness. The excitement and energy were palpable and thrilling to all involved, perhaps nothing more so than the connection between Gwendolyn and Keyshawn, a young organizer from Make the Road by Walking, who was working on a campaign on over-policing. They connected across time and space, and we all saw it. In the sort of moment that flashes all the radical possibilities of life-making, Gwendolyn saw herself in her youth and in Keyshawn now, and he saw his work and future in her. And it was electric, like all the possibilities of radicalism's making and remaking, global, intimate, profound. Thank you. And when I said something to Gwendolyn like a year or so later, you loved Keisha, you know. We saw you fall in love with her. You saw that? I said everybody saw that. But it was just like this kind of reaching across time and space to imagine political activation and activism. All right. Questions or comments?
I have a question. I work on 17th century Spain and its empire, specifically art. So when you were talking about the project, it kept thinking about Spanish colonial maps, which, not totally unlike this, incorporate perspectives and then literally often the labor of the people being colonized. And so in those maps, you get this weird, you know, sort of hybrid Spanish imperial view of, like, the land that we're claiming. But then you also get the people whose land has been claimed who are, you know, often helping to make the maps and sort of shaping in some way the way that they look. And so I'm wondering if in these maps you get that kind of hybrid sense of what's going on in this project.
It's not so hybrid because they're really like radical maps. I mean, you can see them, some of them online, but there's a map. One is capital flows, capital flows from central Detroit to the suburbs, and there's these big, thick black arrows like that show wealth of different kinds. Mm-hmm. The maps of the neighborhood with the rat bite, you know, they're pretty, it's interesting because they're pretty kind of crude sketch maps. Mm-hmm. Now you can imagine giving young people Google Maps, or, you know, like having a way to have a base map that's standardized and symbols that, and that would be more hybrid. But these were truly like handmade maps, and they were all pretty much all from the perspective from those who were in the expedition.
Okay, so you don't get so much the perspective of like Bundy and his paternalistic approach.
Only in the writing.
Okay.
Much more, yeah, not really. I mean, I think he suggested some of the maps, but I think mostly the community people said that should be mapped, and Gwendolyn said that she really had the ideas for the rat bites. He was interested in machine space and those kinds of things, so maybe certain of the things they mapped could be discerned as, you know, from the top down.
Sure, so the gender influence.
But the writing, it's all about the manly work.
First of all, thank you for that. This is wonderful. Mm-hmm. And I'm particularly enthusiastic, because I'm not judged, I guess, about your idea of minor theory, about how you're thinking about that. But so I just want to tell you something that makes you think of it if you don't know about it. If you do.
I'm sure I know.
So I work in queer theory. And 20 years ago, probably the same time you were writing about minor theory, Eve Sedgwick was writing about weak theory. And she wrote about weak theory and strong theory. She took the idea of weak theory from Southern Conference, as a psychologist, from the 60s.
Uh-huh.
And she really, she tried to endorse this idea. And it's doing a lot of the same work you're doing with minor theory, but she's using weak theory. And just a couple very quick things about it. First of all, it very interestingly has a kind of spatial or geographical understanding. Her idea is that weak theory has a kind of smaller domain, and strong theory has a kind of global domain.
Uh-huh.
And then it's very polemical, because her ultimate example of strong theory is paranoia.
Uh-huh.
So it's interesting because it's really at the same moment that you were writing about minor theory, you were writing about minor theory.
Okay, I'll check that out. I love them. Yeah.
I also want to thank you. Very interesting. It's the first time I've heard of minor theory. And,
but not the last.
But no, I think it's first time for it kind of works. Well, in fact, it's definitely affirmational, because one of those things that I say, oh, that's part of what I've been doing. So it's good to have a term to kind of wrap my brain around it and whatnot. So my question is the mapping seems like, in talking about the time space, the mapping seems very relevant. That is the approach of something like broken glass, rat bites, things like that, insofar as kind of getting a tangible indication of what life experiences were. My question is, and it seems, well, I guess, it seems like the role of that was to help shape the political dialogue, because it's saying, you know, this is the real reality. And so, getting to my question is that I'm questioning how specifically taking that exact same approach would be relevant today, because it seems like some of the biggest challenges for inner city neighborhoods, Detroit and Milwaukee, is just affirming the beliefs that these particular neighborhoods have so many issues, and some of my work is indicating actually the exact opposite. Time needs to be identified, be it mapped or otherwise, stories told, that actually there's such positive things. And so how this approach, this radical approach, needs to be kind of nuanced for the time space, because I'm really curious about the role of this research in shaping the political brain and the political discussion by the challengers.
I think that's a good point. I think one of the strengths of something like the UDI or any sort of similar project that might be launched now is that the project itself affirms the positive things that are possible and are going on in the community, but also could match things like community gatherings. Or, you know, it doesn't have to only be that. It could be play spaces that are, or community activities, or maybe the words that would be seen would not all be about sex fashion. You know, so part of how they wrote about it was also activating a political response that showed community engagement, that showed not in the wake of the uprising, which one of the fields of the great rebellion, you know, it was saying, we're still here, and we're going to make this place livable, and you cannot think of us as like people who just couldn't come out to the But I think that you're right, that, I mean, that's one of the things that I'm telling about the atlas of love and truth, is that there's other things to map that should show the way the community works, or the way subjectivity is altered, or where the spots of life are vibrant and kind of vibrant and grow. I mean, it's about community gardens, for example. There are beauty, and there are many, and they're also not just about gardening, but about socializing and learning about the environment and how to do eating and all kinds of things. Well,
thank you for the when you actually yourself take a question from yourself to the world, then you actually another formation of the world that is for us. This is easier to take an introduction. So I was wondering if you want to tell us a little bit about that new better.
About having processes? The thing about, I mean, all of my work in one way or another has been about social reproduction. And I am concerned with the ways it's been offloading from affluent state, et cetera, onto individuals, and how the making of social life is more and more privatized. But I work in specific, as most really say, trying to get in specific profiles. And my idea about campus photography is that these processes and social relations of production and social reproduction are at once global and and that seeing that globality of these social relations is an important way to reimagine political engagement and social life. So I wrote about basically every one
seminar, but my earlier work was in Sudan, in rural Sudan, on children's work and play, the focus of everyday life, and how that was being changed as a result of so-called development, the capitalist state-sponsored agricultural development project. And I saw, one of the things I saw was that children need to be skilled in the process. So they knew exactly how to live as farmers and farmers and farmers as their parents were, but they weren't going to have access to that. And they were not learning until they wanted to know for a different kind of life. And that was profound enough conclusion, but I really did not want it to be like this isolated post-war country in that fourth place that came that's not of us. And so the next part of the project that I did was in New York, which was to be still as a result of the need, when I call it universalization. Post-40s. But the post-40s, I'm staying in a third factory. But in the post-40s industrial environment, as the urban fabric transformed, kids would be distilled in similar ways, abstractly similar ways, not materially similar ways. So that the children who were growing up in Harlem, where I was working at the time, were not learning what they would need to know for informational kind of technology knowledge. It used to be, and I don't want to romanticize the children's path, it used to be a school leader and have studied in a job and have studied life. And that was what was being eroded before by the 1970s. So I thought these two groups of people are experiencing global economic restructuring or loss of globalization in similar ways. The abstract relationship to global economic transformation is seen very differently if you look at it on the back of children than if you look at it for face in Africa or a region or region. And financial flows. So that really understanding the ways the places on the surface are different, are connected, is a way to imagine the world, but oneself in the world, and a political response to a particular condition. So it's not going to modernize the building in New York and the building in Sudan, but to say, de-skilling is happening to children in these very different settings. And if we want to understand the consequences of global economic destruction, this is a way to understand it and respond to it that may be a very different kind of response than thinking about capital flows.
Oh, God.
Are there questions?
If no one's there, then...
Go for it.
If my understanding of your presentation of the minor theory is right, and my earlier reading about the subaltern studies theory to paradigm. I see both the strands of your minor theory and the subaltern studies theory, or especially Zachary's work on can subaltern speak. Do you see a connection between them? Because both of you are talking about kind of space that is emerged from within. You are talking about the story of a narration from and within space, not understood by many academicians in different sort of different languages or for whatever reason. And on the other hand, she's also arguing
almost really at the same point of time, I spent with up and doing a non-manly job of figuring out the doing the publication. I couldn't find it probably around the 1980s, where leap theory was also at the same point of time coming up. Do you see a connection between your reading of the expedition and kind of post-colonial understanding of spaces of the subaltern existence? Is my question clear?
The question is clear. I mean, I can see, but you asked it in different ways. So, because first it was like, is it minor theory connected to post-colonial theory?
No,
and then
that's
it was, is the expedition response?
That's not my question. My question is, can you find the, or can you elaborate on kind of similarities of these two theories that were in public discourse here?
Sure. I have a short answer to that. I mean, I love a connection with Spivak and Sedgwick in one. I can
they both did it important, but I see the connection, and certainly that was incredibly influential. So I don't know how all the things get emerging, you know, or get rework in one head of what we can do and so I can't say that there's a direct connection, and I want to kind of reiterate it's different in a distinction from kind of subaltern speaker, or at least it seems to me distinct, is that the minor theory is really engaging, I guess it could be the same, but this body of work in which one displaces. I mean, the kind of minor literature thing, it's easier to say, but Kafka is a Czech Jew who writes in German. He cannot not write in German, and he cannot be at home in German. And I felt like I cannot not do theory, but I can't do it that way. And yet, I think that what I do is a reworking of this thing that I live in, and that I care about, and that I respect. And that was how I felt about the Kerry James Marshall show. It was just, I don't know how many of you are familiar with his work, but it's profoundly that. You know, and the fact that he called it mastery. You know, I purposely went to see it before coming here because I thought, here I called this refusing mastery, and here he's like playing with mastery by spelling it alternatively, I won't say it wrong, and then really engaging canonical works and canonical ways of working and being as amazing and skilled and profound in his work about a very different kind of subject and about reworking it and insisting that that should change the way some other canonical artist works. So it's like the interstitial part. You know, I know that, I don't know if that really answers the question. I mean, I know that what Spivak was talking about is that the subaltern speaks in the, you know, in
the
silence is speaking.
Just the way you have produced the maps and the neighbors produce the maps, it's almost what subaltern is hooking on, or rather whose language is not understood by the rest, the elite. Therefore, they speak through action. So somewhere map thinking and action becomes almost, to my understanding, similar kind of traits that were designed to find the view.
It was certainly action, and it was speaking more to themselves than to
the outer world. Yeah.
The other world, you know, it was really consciousness raising and neighborhood changing. Of course, it aspired also to speak to the powers that be in Detroit and elsewhere, but most of it was a way of organizing, which is, you know, I think it's quite powerful because it was
knowledge, power, learning, producing, and engaging with where they live. That's so much. Did you want to? Are you? No? Okay.
Not, please join me in thanking the city.